The date is December 1st, 1996. This is an interview with Liberator James Zuidema. The interviewer is David Klinger. We are in Muskegon, Michigan, United States, and the language is English.
Do you want those lights turned off for a minute?
No, it's fine. Okay, we're on.
Okay. My name is David Klinger. Last name is spelled K-L-I-N-G-E-R. This is an interview with Mr. James Zuidema in Muskegon, Michigan. Today is December 1st, 1996. Mr. Zuidema is a liberator. Could you give us your full name, please, and spell it?
James L. Lewis Zuidema, Z-U-I-D-E-M-A.
Okay, and that is the name that you had at birth as well?
Yes.
Okay. And you were born on?
February 2nd, 1926.
And where was that?
Muskegon, Michigan.
And your current age?
70.
Okay. Can you tell us something about your childhood, please?
Brought up during the Depression. We went to St. Mary's School, graduated from St. Mary's School all the way through. We lived about a block, a mile from the downtown. And my dad worked at the dairy, so we always had something to eat. A lot to drink, but not too much to, you know. So we weren't too bad off during the Depression. He did work.
And you had brothers and sisters?
I have four brothers, three brothers and two sisters and a foster brother.
Okay. Were there any other family members living with your family at the time?
Yes, I had two uncles who were probably four or five years older than I was. I'm the oldest one that lived with us. I never called them uncle because they were more like my brothers. One of them was killed at Anzio, and the other one was in the Air Force all through Africa and up through Italy till the end of the war. He just died a year ago.
Okay. When you were in high school, you were aware that the war was going on. What was the feeling in high school at the time that among students?
It was very, very patriotic. A lot of the kids were getting called out before they graduated. I had turned 18 just before I graduated, and I was trying to get into the Air Force, Air Cadets. My blood pressure was a little bit high, and kept going back and forth to Detroit. And finally, they cut out the cadets completely, and I was supposed to be drafted, and Sister Martin, the principal at St. Mary's, made such a stink about taking me before I graduated. This was in probably maybe March, early April, that she got me a deferment until I graduated, and in doing so, she got a deferment for the whole city. Some of the kids left the next night, but I had about 2 weeks because I signed up for immediate induction, so it took them longer immediately.
So you enlisted? So,
yeah, more. Well, I was inducted by a sort of enlisted, more or less. But everybody was gung-ho to go then. It was nothing like Vietnam or anything like that. Mm-hmm. Very patriotic.
Did you get a lot of news of what was happening in the war?
Pretty much. The hardest thing for me was when my uncle was killed, because he was so close to us. So I felt that I had to go right now, you know. Mm-hmm. My dad almost went the same time I did. He was just 20 years older than I am. But they gave him a deferment as an essential industry, which was the dairy. So he didn't go, but we almost went the same time.
Had you heard anything of the persecutions that, that were going on in Europe?
There was some rumors, especially about the end of 1955 when the Russians liberated Auschwitz and Birkenwald and a couple other places. But people, we didn't take it too seriously because after the First World War, there were a lot of rumors of atrocities, and they all proved to be false. It was just propaganda. I don't know if you're familiar with how they used to the Germans as the Huns and monsters and all that, and it was all false. So in World War II, they just figured more or less that it's just propaganda, and the Russians they had a real bad chip to, you know, on their shoulder, and they had an axe to grind. So I don't think the people really believed it, and that's why we didn't really believe it when we walked in that first day. I mean,
so you enlisted on what date?
Went in the Army June 28th, 1944.
And you did basic training?
In Fort Sill, Oklahoma. Then I went directly, came home for 10 days, went to Columbia, South Carolina, and was sent directly to Fort Sill, Oklahoma. The 65th Division was already packed, ready to leave to go overseas.
Did you get any specialized type of training?
I had basic training on a 105 howitzer. So when I got into 65th, they put me on the a wire crew telephone. I didn't know anything about that stuff.
When you were in training, did the Army mention anything about any concentration camps or anything that had been discovered by?
No. Mm-mm.
Okay. So you did your basic training, and then you were assigned to the 65th?
Infantry Division, Headquarters Battery Division Artillery.
Okay. And when did you ship to Europe?
New Year's Eve.
What year was that?
It had been 44 or 45, depending on what time of day he was. It was January 1st, 1945.
And you shipped out from?
New York.
New York. Do you remember the name of the ship?
No, but it was a Italian luxury liner. It was taken over by the Germans, and we had captured it, and we were using it as a troop ship. It was a big, like a big cruise ship. We were in a convoy of, I think, about 600 ships. And in January, the Northern Atlantic is very, very rough. All you saw was water, then you'd see sky, and then water and sky. Everybody got sick. I lived on ketchup and bread until we landed.
Do you remember who your commanding officer was?
At the time, it was Captain Koschel. He just died about a month ago.
And do you remember if there were any Jewish soldiers in your unit?
Oh, yeah. We had Headquarters Battery. Divardi wasn't a real big battery. It was more of a service to the headquarters staff, the general and the colonels and all that. But we had, I would say, probably six or seven Jewish guys. Most of them spoke Yiddish or German.
Do you know if they had heard anything about atrocities or persecutions? Or was it an issue that was talked about?
Like I say, there was talk, but I don't nobody seemed to believe it. You know, rumors, but like I mentioned, like in World War I, everything proved out false, so people were getting letters. The people that got out of Germany, of course, didn't know what was going on once they had left. And so I don't know if the Jewish people really, you know, the guys in their outfit knew what was going on or what. It's hard to say. We never really talked about that much. We're busy worrying about other things.
What were the concerns? What were people feeling as they were going across?
Get the war over with. Fight. Get it over with. There was a tremendous patriotic surge. It's when you stop and think about the way things were with Vietnam, the way people looked at the soldiers and stuff, it was entirely different to World War II. Everybody was in there doing their part. It was entirely different, and we couldn't wait to get over there and get in, chase the Germans away, you know, make the world safe for democracy, stuff like that. We had a lot of indoctrination stuff like that during the war, you know, during our training.
Did that continue on the ship?
Not too much. Everybody was too sick. Including the officers in general.
Okay. Where did you land?
In Le Havre. We were supposed to land in the northern part of England. That's where our advanced detail was setting up camp for us, so we could unpack our stuff. You know, all our equipment had to be cleaned, cosmoline off it, you know, so it wouldn't rust and stuff. And the submarines were too bad up in that area, so they ran us around the south end into Le Havre. And we went into what they call Camp Lucky Strike. All that was there was tents. There was no food, no heat. It was a mess. And our advanced detail got there about an hour before we did, so you know what the conditions were. It was terrible. And the first thing they did was took our trucks and sent them up to the bulge, you know, carry supplies and stuff, because they were very short of trucks. We eventually got our trucks back, otherwise we wouldn't have moved. But it was a cold winter. I was lucky. I was too young to know what to do, so they stuck me in the chateau as a runner between the two generals, and for a while at least I stayed warm, although everybody else was freezing.
So you were able to stay there? Or?
Not very long, but at least I had a little bit, because for a while there we didn't have any heat or anything. It was miserable.
Where were the front lines at that point in time?
Front lines were, they had just pushed the bulge back, and they were still fighting in that area. They were back to where they were Christmas when the Germans broke through in what they called the bulge. And when we went into combat, we relieved the 26th Division near Sarlaten, which is Saarlouis now. It's in Metz, just east of Metz in that area. It was this side of the Saar River and this side of the Siegfried Line.
Okay.
And it was more or less to the far eastern edge of France all the way down, more or less. And we hadn't crossed the Rhine yet, and we hadn't got to the Siegfried Line yet.
How long did you spend at Le Havre?
In Le Havre?
Yes.
No time at all. We just got off the boat and went to we were in Camp Lucky Strike a week or so, you know, unpacking and stuff like that, getting our trucks back and because everything's got to be clean. Everything is covered with grease, you know, on the ship. Then we went directly into combat. Then it took us about 2 days to drive from the west side of France, Le Havre, to the east side near Metz.
Did you encounter any civilians en route?
Oh yeah, all through all the towns. They were, of course, they had been liberated already, the French. So, but they were very friendly to us. Very friendly.
During this period of time, did you hear any of the German propaganda broadcasts?
No, we didn't have any radios.
Did you have?
Maybe headquarters did, but the men didn't, that I know of.
Did you have access to any army publications or?
No, we didn't either.
So?
We were moving awfully fast.
Okay, so you moved to the front lines at that point?
Yeah.
Which were in eastern France?
Eastern France, near Sarlaten, be east of Metz in that area. Saarbrücken, Nancy is in that area somewhere, I don't know. We went north of Paris through Verdun, Chateau Thierry, in that area, and then swung down. It's not too far from the Belgian border. I mean, not right on the border, but it's in that area where Belgium and France and Germany all kind of come together.
And do you recall the date that you arrived there?
No, I don't.
What happened when you got there then?
Well, we moved in and the 26th Division moved out. And they had been there practically all through the bulge since Christmas time. And it was more or less a stable situation. And then when they moved out, we started battering the Germans and everybody on the line started moving. We crossed the Saar River, took Sarlaten and, oh, I don't know how many different towns in there. We broke through the Siegfried Line. That stopped us about 2 hours. Didn't stop us hardly at all.
Do you remember what the date was then?
No, a day was the same. One day is no Sundays, no Mondays, just days. And then we crossed the Rhine. I personally crossed the Rhine at a little after 3 on Good Friday because people were coming out of church from the triori service on Good Friday, so I knew exactly what time it was. But then from then on, we just went, we called it the rat race. We just made a beeline for Berlin. I was with Patton's Third Army.
Mm-hmm. And the Army was progressing fast? At
that point. Oh, yeah. The 65th Division at one time was on a spearhead, and we were the closest division of any of the Allies to Berlin. We even made Ripley's Believe It or Not back in the States. They wrote us up in that column
for
being the closest, and we were on a spearhead. And that's when Eisenhower sent down the order to stop. We weren't supposed to go any further. We had just had Erfurt. Ordruff is quite near Erfurt, not too far from Erfurt. And Erfurt is due south of Berlin, probably 100 miles. And we were north of Erfurt. We just had a big battle with a large group of SS troops. And it was quite a bloody battle. And And that's when and we were starting on our way back to Berlin again, and that's when we got the orders. Normally, at this time, the Wehrmacht weren't doing anything. They may, if you see a group of just ordinary soldiers, they might fire a few shots in the air and throw down their rifles and surrender, or they just turn away and walk away. So we didn't pay any attention to them. It's because, you know, a lot of times we were out there all by ourselves. And we had to watch out for the SS. And then Eisenhower gave this order and stopped us and let the Russians go into Berlin and pulled us back to the, it would be, at the time we were probably 40 miles northeast of Ohrdruf, and the 6th Army, the 6th Armored Division was about 30 miles southwest on an angle like that of Ohrdruf, and they, I heard all this afterwards, I didn't know at the time, but they got word that there was a large underground communication center built in Ohrdruf, in the town, and they wanted permission to go that extra few miles in to capture that communication center. Well, at the same time, we were coming back and they were going this way, so we made a crossing maneuver, which is very usual for us. We were, you know, like leapfrogging a lot. So that's how we all happened to get in the same spot at the same time.
Did you encounter many German civilians at this time?
Oh, yeah. Not a whole lot, but the ones we did were very cooperative, very friendly. No problem whatsoever. We didn't run into any problem. And at one time... I remember one time, it's beside the point, but they didn't have me on the switchboard this night, so they took me out on the, when we were laying our wire, we lay wire from the advance headquarters back to our old headquarters. We just kept jumping like this, day after day after day, and we'd lay wire backwards. We'd go to where we were going to, our new headquarters, and then lay wire back. That way we knew where we were going, and they left me there in the middle of the night, cold, all by myself in this house with a telephone. The sergeant had a bottle of Goldwasser. It's a liqueur with gold leaf, real gold floating around in it. Some officer gave it to him, and he gave me that. He says, "This will keep you warm." When they came back for me in the morning, I was sitting in the corner with my pistol and my carbine in an empty bottle. Oh, I was so scared. I was all out by myself. Germans all around us, but they were Wehrmacht, so we didn't have too much to worry about. But if one of them walked into this house, I would have died. but that's the SS we had to worry about, but not the Wehrmacht.
Did you take many prisoners?
Yeah, we took quite a few. While back, just before this all happened, we had liberated a French camp that had a lot of women in. I don't know what it was, but they weren't. It wasn't like a labor camp. It was more like a PW camp. But there was an awful lot of women there for some reason. I remember going in it, that's all I remember about it. But I do know that we did liberate one French PW camp. So if that was the camp, it must have been the one.
Do you recall where that was located?
No, it was before this time. Someplace just west of Ohrdruf in that area.
Do you recall how many people were there?
Oh, there must have been 400 or 500. There were a lot. But they were in good condition. They didn't look like they were nothing like the slave labor camps, the, you know, that we were found afterwards. It was, but these were fairly, we didn't know much. We didn't know much about what was going on. You knew what was going on 10 feet away from you, but if it was 20 feet, you didn't really know what was going on. I just remember going in and, you know, walking through these, talking to these people, and not talking to them, you know, because we didn't speak their language, but going into the camp. And but I found out afterwards it was supposed to be a French PW camp, but why there were so many women there, I don't know.
Were there a lot of French men as well?
Yeah, there were men, but there were a lot of women too. So I really don't know what the whole thing was about on that one.
Gentlemen, we'll stop here for a moment. This is tape two of an interview with Mr. James Zuidema in Muskegon, Michigan, December 1st, 1996.
Okay.
We were talking about a French prisoner of war camp that you had also seen.
That's, I really don't remember too much about it except going into it. It was nothing like Ordruff. I mean, the people looked fairly healthy. They seemed happy to see us. Of course, we didn't speak very few guys spoke any French. And but that's about all I remembered. But we had run into something like that before, so that kind of gave us a little idea of what was going on. And then when we ran into Ordruff, it was completely different, you know, to see something way different.
As the army was moving, did you encounter a lot of refugees?
Yeah, a lot of people on the roads coming back, going back towards our lines, because most of the main cities we hit pretty hard ahead of us. And if there was any problem with German troops, especially the SS, our artillery would just pound the dickens out of them before the attack. And so if they were in town, the towns got it. And plus the towns were bombed quite heavy too. Any town of any size was bombed quite heavily, so the people had to go somewhere, and they couldn't. The Germans wouldn't let them go east, and so they just more or less went west because we just let them go through.
Do you recall any particular interactions with any groups of people, or was it really just passing by?
No, we were moving so fast that I mean you didn't even have time to really think.
Do you know if you ever encountered any Jewish people who were refugees or who were moving away from the fighting?
I don't know. I couldn't say for sure. one of the, I didn't run into him personally, but one of my buddies was Jewish, and he spoke German and Yiddish, and they brought him to headquarters, and a young girl had come in and wanted to see an American Jew, and she was Jewish, but she was masquerading as, what was it? Not German, but either Czech or Polish or something like that. She was, and they, you know, she had all the papers and everything, but she actually was Jewish, and someone had got her one of the churches, or a lot of the churches gave them baptismal certificates to say that they were Christian. And that's a lot of people, cause most of them you couldn't tell by their name anyway. But she was Jewish, and she wanted to talk to an American Jew, and that's this one guy they brought in. That's the only one that I can remember really anything had any direct contact. Because most of them by that time were either in Poland, at Auschwitz, or gone. I mean, or in the camps, hadn't been released or anything. And no camp had been released yet, other than the one that I know of is the French. And there were no Jews in there. It was strictly French POWs. It was like Stalag, you know, Stalag 17 or whatever it is.
Did the Jewish girl talk much, do you know, about her experiences, or?
From what I hear, she just broke down. I mean, she was holding it in for so long. She had to talk to someone, and you know, and get, because all she had to have was one person say, she's not a Christian, she's a Jew, and she would have been gone. So it was probably real hard for her. So by talking, finding someone like that, then he could. And of course, he turned her over to the American authorities, you know, and they moved her out and stuff. But other than that, I don't know of any other case personally that I know of a person that had any contact up until we actually went into our order.
How did the American GI react to this encounter?
With Ordruff?
No, with the young girl.
Their hearts just went out to her. I mean, no, she was telling things that we didn't know. I think, though, still there was that in the back of our minds, things like that aren't happening. It can't happen. This is a civilized country. You just don't do things like that, even though you got someone right there telling you that does.
Did she talk about camps or executions or movement of people?
I don't know. I never talked to her personally. I'm just telling you what I heard, you know, what he told afterwards. But evidently she lost most of her family. At that time, she just thought they were separated. She hoped to find them.
Okay. So the army was moving along, and you were located where about this time?
We were probably, I would say, 75 to 80 miles almost due south of Berlin. We could have gone in within less than 2 weeks.
Okay.
At the rate we were going.
And you were looking for the communications?
Yeah. Actually, we weren't looking for the community. It was the 6th Armored, I think it was, had word. We were already past it. because we were way ahead of anybody else. We were all way out on the spearhead all by ourselves. Mm-hmm. So we came back, and they came forward, and we came back.
Okay, and then what happened?
Well, they just missed Von Runstead, by one day, we hear.
He was
the big German general.
Okay.
One of the number one guys. And from what we hear now, I think it was Goebbels was preparing a big suite for Hitler for his birthday, which was in April, middle of April sometime, I think it was, in this underground communication center, big elaborate suite. And of course, they went in the town, and this one particular time, we were. It's a maneuver that's common. We were doing it all the time. One division would go ahead, and we would fall back. Then they would fall back, and we would go ahead. We were leapfrogging instead of just pushing. I mean, it was kind of, and. So we came, the 6th Armored was coming east, and we were coming southwest and crossed over. And we were going to lay a wire from our new headquarters back, and we only had one wire crew in headquarters battery. We just laid the one wire from headquarters to headquarters, and everybody else laid wires to us. And division laid wires to us. Division did, and it just happened to come across this camp. The way I remember it was almost a solid wall of buildings along a road, very near to a road, and there was a gate. And as we were approaching, there were other GIs in the vicinity, and there was some gunfire and there were two German guards at the gate, and they were shot and killed. And by the time we got there, there was quite a commotion, and people running around almost like chickens with their head chopped off. Nobody knew what to do.
The people who were running around were who?
All GIs. we went into the camp, and that's when we saw it.
You entered through the gate on foot.
Yeah. Now, I don't remember if there was a Arbeit Macht Frei over the gate, that's over all the camps that they say in Germany, work will make you free. I don't remember if that was there. All I remember is the two, I'm positive it was two dead Germans laying there. And then we went in, and this the first thing more or less we saw was this like a courtyard, and all these dead bodies laying in kind of more or less a group. And I went back out to our wire truck and got my camera. It was a little baby brownie, plastic baby brownie. It took 128 film, which is probably about the size of a 35 millimeter today. I had one picture left on the roll, and that's all the film I had. And that was the first thing I saw, so that was I took that picture. And that picture, even though it was the first thing I saw, was quite a famous picture, because that is the exact same picture that was shown all over the world of Eisenhower and Patton and all his entourage viewing the bodies. These bodies lay in there, except my picture didn't have any of the generals standing around looking. I always tell the people when I talk to them, when I give a lecture on it, my picture is showing what they saw, and the other picture shows who saw it. But then we start walking, you know, there weren't very many prisoners alive. These were all had been shot just hours before. They had taken all the prisoners who could walk and marched them out, and because they knew we were coming, and these people weren't strong enough or something, and they just shot them there. And then the ones that were still alive were just scattered throughout, you know, in the camp, in various places. They were absolutely just walking skeletons. That's all they were. No expression on their face, blank eyes. Oh, God. See, the worst part is I see all this stuff. I can't get it out of my mind. Most of them, very few of them, maybe one or two of them could talk. They were just, I don't know if they knew who we were or not. They didn't show any emotion to what I could see. Maybe afterwards when they realized what was going on. But oh man, it absolutely no expression, just gone. I don't know who was in more shock, the prisoners or us. I think most of the first few minutes, hour or so, everybody was just seemed to be just wandering around, looking. A couple inmates did come and kind of show us around. We went into some of the barracks. There were dead bodies all in there. From what I understand now, when a person died, the inmates had to dispose of the bodies, and when the people became so weak that they couldn't, the bodies just laid there. So you'd see maybe a living person, a living corpse laying there, and right next to them, maybe four or five dead ones. You couldn't tell one from the other, except the one moved a little bit. We saw one room that bodies were just piled up like cordwood. I think that probably was the room that where Patton got sick. Because I'm telling this from what I hear. That when he saw this one room piled up with bodies, he got sick to his stomach and had to leave. And I think this was probably the room that he was talking about. There's a picture of it there. But then we found the mass graves, just great big huge holes, just scooped out of the earth with bulldozers. Where the bodies were thrown in. When I talk to the kids or anybody, I tell them, give you some idea what it looked like. Just take a piece of paper, take a pencil, and start making little marks all over. And when you get the whole paper all covered, that's a diagram of what these graves looked like. With the bodies just thrown in all over, arms sticking up, legs sticking up, butt sticking up, head sticking up, you know, all over. Most of them naked. Some of them had clothes on. There were evidence that they were trying to burn the bodies. You got to remember, we're going into this place cold, and not knowing anything what's going on anywhere. So some of this, what I'm telling, I found out afterwards, and relating it to what we saw. But evidently, even though this was just a labor camp where they were systematically starving the people to death, which is a more horrible form of death than putting them in a gas chamber like they did in Auschwitz, that they were trying to hide some of these bodies. They were actually digging up, pulling bodies out of these mass graves and trying to burn them before the Americans and or whoever got there. There were signs. They had brought ovens and stuff in. Some places they were just piles of bodies, like on railroad ties, not ties, no, the rails, iron rails, make like a grill, and pile the bodies up on that and burning them that way. Anywhere you went, there were bodies all over. There were some buildings that they were like using them for. They weren't really barracks because they weren't that type of building. It was more like a cow barn with a big door on one end and a big door on the other end with an aisle down the center. And most of them had bunks in them, and we went through them, and there weren't too many living people left, but the ones that were laying in their bunks, then they just stare at you. Oh, it's hard to describe. That's why I think the pictures and stuff are so important. But there were a lot of dead bodies in there that, you know, they hadn't taken out. So maybe some of these dead people, or the ones that were still alive, they thought were dead and just left them. One barn didn't have any bunks at all in it. It was just empty. And they were just laying around, bodies laying around. But over in the corner, this one man, this one living skeleton, I'll never forget him. He was sitting up against the wall, and his feet were pulled up like this, and he was just absolutely terrified. He just sat there, never moved. He was alive, but these people, most of them were to a point where if you just said, they would have died right there. I mean, if they were that close to death, so you don't know what they were thinking. I never think about the other ones that were still alive, but I always, that one there, even to this day, I wonder if he made it. One thing I'm really thankful for, I never thought about at the time, I was always sorry we didn't, but we didn't have any food with us. At least my group didn't. There were just three or four of us in my party. We didn't have any water with us because we were expecting to go to this next town, lay the wire back, and we'd be back at our headquarters. So we didn't have anything to give these people. And the blessing is that we didn't, because we know now that it would have killed them instantly. A good drink of water, and our food that we had, you know, K rations and stuff like that, was all highly concentrated. and it would have killed them right on the spot. They couldn't have handled it. All they could handle was maybe some hot water with a chicken fanned over the top of it. That's about as strong as they could. And Ordruff, even though it was a small camp, they don't know too much about it, because when the Germans left, they took all their records, and we never did find them. They think there's probably maybe 7,000 in the camp at one time, and out of anybody that was left, it was less than 75 that we found alive. And I doubt if 25 survived out of the 75, because they were too far gone. I mean, you can go to a certain point and it's just more as a point of no return on that type of starvation, I think. So many of them died. And I know our medics, when they came in, had no experience on stuff like that. And I can just imagine them trying to give them something to eat, which was the worst thing they could have done. So I that's one thing I always hope, that at least some of them, you know, survive, because we were dumb about such things like that. We didn't know what to do. This is the first camp that we came into, and I really, at the time, I don't think we fully appreciate, I hate to say appreciate, or fully realize what we were walking into, if you know what I mean. To see something like this, we had never seen human beings in that condition. We had just been through a POW camp, and everybody looked halfway decent. I mean, they weren't fat, but they were alive and at least semi-healthy. But to walk into a place like that where the people should have been dead months before, I don't think, and for maybe hours, that people, the GIs, really realized what they had walked into. Maybe until the news of it got to the headquarters, where they knew what was going on. We didn't. I mean, the ordinary GI doesn't know what's going on. We didn't know from one town to the next where we were, or where we were going, or what we were doing, or what we were supposed to do. We just did it. We got to stop now.
Sure. This is tape 3 of an interview with Liberator James Zuidema in Muskegon, Michigan, December 1st, 1996.
This one barn, like I was telling about this one man, it's of all it's I don't know, it's hard to say you ignored the rest of them, but this one was the one that got my attention. You would think that they would have been overjoyed to see us, but then you wonder, did they even know who we were? Were their minds gone with their other human capabilities? They were so close to death that you wonder sometimes what they were even thinking. And I know other places they say when they came in they were overjoyed and ran around. But when you see something where people don't do much, of course in this camp it was a little bit different because the only ones left there supposedly were dead or had been shot just before the Germans pulled out. So maybe they were too far gone to be happy. But you always wonder, did any of them make it? Sure hope so. God.
Do you recall what the date was when you entered the camp?
Not the exact date. It was about the first, almost the about the 1st of April. Mm-hmm. I know if it was the 1st, 2nd, 3rd, something, I don't know. Eisenhower didn't go in until I think the 11th or 12th. What happened after the reports, of course, when after we, we were working. I mean, we weren't infantry. We had a job to do. We had to get this telephone line in. I think most of the other guys there were could have been infantry or more combat type. Not that we weren't combat, but we weren't in the handgun shooting type. The front lines, we were back a little bit. So actually, I think after we left, they brought the medics and stuff in, and of course, then headquarters found out, and Patton went. I don't know if he went that first day or he went the next day or what it was. But then he tried to get Eisenhower to come, and Eisenhower didn't want to. And I guess it took a little bit of coaxing, and finally Eisenhower said, okay, I'll come. If it's what you say it is, the only reason I'm telling this from what I've read, Eisenhower said that he was just going to do it so he personally could vouch for what was being seen. And so then that's when he went in, Eisenhower, Patton, Bradley, I don't know. One of my buddies was there at that time when Eisenhower was there. I've looked for his picture in the newsreels and stuff. I've got quite a collection of all tapes I've been collecting over the years, but I've never seen them. But there were so many at that time. Of course, when I took my picture, there was very few. I don't think there's a GI on my picture at all.
How many of you actually entered the camp initially?
I don't think more than 20, 25 at the most.
Do you remember what the weather was like?
I think it was a nice day. It was cold.
Do you know what time of day, roughly what time of day that was?
No, I don't.
How far from the town was the camp?
I don't know, a mile or so maybe. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
Okay.
If I knew then what I know now, I would have taken more details. I would wrote stuff down. But we didn't know what we were getting into. We didn't know we were making history. So, you know, hindsight is a lot better than foresight. So a lot of details you don't remember. I can remember going back to Rome. I knew where all the places were, but I didn't know how to get there. I'd been there, but even when I went back to Vienna, I went back to the house that I lived in. Well, it's not a house, it's like an apartment, but they don't have houses like we do in town. And I had to stand there, and I just closed my eyes and try to go back 40-some years and just to picture what I did when I came in the building, because your memory sometimes, little things like that you don't pay no attention to, that you do every day. So a lot of things about the camps and stuff. I do remember that there were buildings along, looked like a solid wall of buildings. There was no fence per se. It was like the backs of buildings with this big gate. Like I said, I don't remember any sign over the top, which they say every camp in Germany had this sign, "Work will make you free, Arbeit macht frei." I don't remember that. But once inside the camp, most of this stuff is just burnt right into my brain.
Aside from the two,
I think it was the shock effect. I mean, the shock maybe burnt it in, where some of the details outside and stuff, what happened before, what happened after, are so immaterial that I just don't pay no attention to it. I mean, we live day by day, and we're lucky to see another morning. And so a lot of the details I don't really remember, but the details, the pictures inside, I could sit down and draw you pictures. It's they're that almost that clear in my mind yet.
Mm-hmm. Aside from the two guards that you encountered, were there any other German mm-hmm. military around? Were you able to communicate at all with any of the people that you found in the camp?
We didn't personally. Like I said, there weren't very many walking around. There was only just a very, very few. If there was a half a dozen walking around, that was a lot. And they were in no condition. I'm sure some of them, when more people probably got in there that could speak German or something, it may have made a difference to find out. We don't know what nationalities they were, whether they were Jewish or political or what. We don't know too much about Ordre. Mm-hmm. That's the only camp that they don't have the statistics, how many people had gone through the camp, who the people were. Most of the other camps, they have all the records. They can tell you who went through the camp, because they took excellent records. And but I don't know why that being the first camp, they took everything and
how many buildings, barrack type buildings, would you guess there were?
Oh, on the more or less the built the barracks type of buildings, there must have been a couple dozen at least. It was pretty good sized camp. And these big barn-type buildings, I don't know how many there were. Like I say, most of them had bunks, but this one or two didn't have any bunks in it. It was just straw, more or less. We weren't looking at the buildings.
Did you go through any buildings that would have been used by guards or by camp administration? Or
I didn't go in, but some of the guys did go in, and I heard that they had found some lampshades made out of tattoos and stuff, but I didn't see any of those myself, but they said there were some. I think most of these inmates, they worked in a factory nearby. It was a slave labor type thing.
Mm-hmm. How long did you actually spend in the camp?
About 2 or 3 hours. We couldn't spend any more time. We had to get those wires laid because we were moving so fast. And so we left. There were other units there. I don't know how many guys from different units were there. It was one of those things that we just happened to, everybody just kept rolling in and rolling in. It spread pretty fast. And yeah. I don't remember much after that. I don't remember what happened after that in our unit type thing.
Do you remember talking to anybody in the unit about what you had seen or any officers in the unit?
Oh yeah, everybody was talking about it. Nobody could believe it. But I still is. Now we weren't up high. We did have a one-star general that commanded the artillery in our battery. We didn't have any access to any big rumors like, were going around, stuff like that. So I would say it took quite a while. Not days or months or anything like that, but it took quite a while for to sink in what was really going on. Even when he got back to so-called higher echelons in our own division, I don't think they realized until I got to maybe Third Army Patton himself that they knew what was going on, really. They found something, but I don't think they knew what they found.
What was the reaction in your unit when you started telling people what you had seen?
Almost disbelief. And then afterwards, some of our group did go back and go in. Of course, afterwards, once Eisenhower got through, one source says Eisenhower said it. Another source says Patton said it, but it doesn't make any difference who said it. But they gave the order that everybody possible was supposed to go through, and they start bringing the civilians in from town, and GIs, American, British, French, whoever, anyone in the vicinity came in. So some of our other guys did. Most of the guys I've talked to at our reunions, very few of them actually went through. The ones that did were afterwards. We just happened to, our wire crew just happened to be in the right place, I guess in the right time, I don't know. Mm-hmm. If you can call that the right, you know, being right.
Where did the unit go from there?
We paused to just kind of regroup after pulling back, and we turned right around. Instead of going almost due north to Berlin, we went right straight down the middle of Germany, through Bamberg, Nuremberg, Munich area, although we didn't go right into Munich. We took Regensburg and the day the war ended, we had just taken Linz, Austria. So all in all, the 65th made through Germany, traveled 650 some odd miles. That's more than any other unit, because we went from the German border almost, well, practically almost spit on Berlin practically, and then came right straight down the middle. And by the time that we stopped, we were trying to meet the Russians, and we had advance groups almost in Vienna. So that's a long, long way.
Did you see evidence of any other camps?
I didn't personally, but the 65th has. We didn't get any credit for Ohrdruf, although we did have people there. We got credit for two other camps similar to Ohrdruf that were slave labor camps. We were in on Mauthausen in northern Austria. That was where the big stone quarry was. So there was three or four. There were a couple that we were there but didn't get. Maybe we didn't have enough guys there. Maybe we didn't have enough guys at Ohrdruf. But most of our records were lost in the fire in St. Louis. So it's kind of, so we had to rely mostly on our own records to get the recognition. Our flag is now in the Holocaust Museum in Washington. It's one of the ones that flies there.
Did you yourself encounter any other camps?
No, that was the only one.
As news of the various camps that were liberated spread around, what was the reaction of the army?
We were mad as hell, I'll tell you. You know, it's especially if you had Jewish guys in your outfit, and we had maybe a half a dozen. It was hard. You talk to the German people, and they could live right outside the gate, and they swore up and down they didn't know anything about it. Maybe some of them didn't, but you can't smell burning flesh and not know something's going on, or see a railroad train come in day after day after day and bringing people in and don't bring anybody out. There is such thing as not wanting to know, because if they knew, they might do something and they could end up in the place themselves. Because the German, Hitler threw just as many Germans almost as anybody else in. His own people. It wasn't just Jews and Polish and Czechs and Slavs and Gypsies and stuff like that. A lot of them were his own people.
Did you personally talk to many German civilians?
Yeah, mostly after the war, after combat was over. And then we had German. I lived in a little town in northern Austria, within walking distance of where Hitler was born. And we didn't have any KP or anything. The German civilians did all our work for us. And in turn, they got food and stuff, too. Of course, a lot of guys were shacking up with the girls and stuff, and, you know. But I was too young. I was fresh out of the convent school. But that's beside the point. But we had a lot of DPs around that first summer. They were...
A DP meaning?
Displaced persons. Okay. That had come in. Most of them were Hungarian. We had a lot of kids. We had a swimming pool, and we let the... Not too many adults came to swim in it, but a lot of kids. I got pictures of a lot of the little kids, 7, 8 years old, you know, around that area.
Do you know if any of the displaced persons were in any of the concentration camps?
Not that I know. I didn't run into any. I don't know where these people came from. They just came out of the cracks in the wall. It seemed like they just appeared. The place we were was a sulfur bath resort the first summer, and they just came out of the woodwork. Of course, they had to go someplace where people would give them food, because there was nothing doing. There was no work.
When the war ended, you were in the Linz area. What happened? Where did you go then? Did you spend time there, or did you move on someplace else?
The war ended. We had just taken Linz, and the 65th Division was practically the whole north end of Austria. That whole area was our front. And, of course, when the war ended, we just stayed put for a week or so. I personally was in the monastery at St. Florian. That's where Anton Bruckner, the famous Austrian composer, was the organist. I got to play his organ up at the church one day. A couple of nuns took me up and showed me it and asked me if I wanted to play it. I said, sure. And then we went to another town north, kind of northwest of Linz. Bad Schallerbach was a sulfur bath resort. We stayed there for the summer, and then we moved around again, and then we were packing to go to Japan, and about, I don't know, end of July, first of August, in that area somewhere, we got orders, that's it, your division's being deactivated, that's it, were not going to Japan, and so most of the guys were all old enough to be my father, practically. They all went home, and about three of us kids stayed in one room for about a week, and another division moved in. Then they went home. We sat in the, for another week by ourselves, and another division moved in. And then finally, they sent me to Vienna.
And what did you do in Vienna?
I was General Clark's chief clerk in his private office. My desk was right outside of his office door.
What rank were you at that time?
Sergeant.
And how long did you spend in Vienna?
6 months.
And at the end of that 6 months?
I came home and got married.
Came home and got married. Okay. Let's stop here for the tape. This is an interview with Liberator Mr. James Zuidema in Muskegon, Michigan, December the 1st, 1996, and this is tape 4. So they sent you home. Do you remember what month that was?
June.
What happened then, sir?
Came home. I got home just about, I was discharged on June 30th. 1946 at 1 o'clock, having gone in on June 28th, so it was 2 hours, 2 days, no, 2 years, 2 hours, 2 days and 2 hours I was in the Army. And came home. My brother was in the seminary and working at the dairy during the summer, and he wanted to take a couple weeks off, so I'd lived at the dairy practically my whole life. My dad worked there. My brother asked the boss if I could take his place for a couple weeks, and Dave says, sure, Jimmy can come in, no problem. So I stayed 5.5 years. I used to tell him they couldn't fire me because he never hired me. Bill came back, and they never told me I was done, so I just stayed.
Did you talk to family and friends back in Muskegon about what you had seen?
Not very much. I just mentioned it. Before my mother died, when it came out in the paper a couple years ago, she didn't even remember me ever mentioning it.
Two people that you mentioned it, do you recall how they reacted to what they heard?
You mean before?
Immediately when you came back, when you spoke to family or friends about it, do you remember how they reacted?
Kind of blasé, more, oh, that was nice that you were there, something like that, more or less. By that time, there was so much about it, you know. So many camps the British had gone in, Bergen-Belsen, towards the end of April. Buchenwald was taken April 11th. That was almost in a direct line east of Ordruff, probably 40, 50 miles. Nordhausen, just north of Ordruff, was taken. There were camps, there were hundreds of camps. I think in Germany there were over 300 or 400 camps all over. Practically anywhere you went, there was a camp of some sort. Saw that they were coming fast and saw, you might say, they flooded the market with experiences of stuff like that. So it became more everyday occurrence when people say, well, I was there, I saw this, I saw that, you know. I don't remember anybody really getting upset about it until just the last 5 or 6 years. Things have been coming out more than what it did before.
How did the experience impact you?
Well, up until just a few years ago, for a while there, I almost got to the point when I didn't think that Ordruff really existed. I knew I had in my photo album Ordruff, and on my paper that we wrote up after the war ended, more or less in like an itinerary. But when you hear all about all the other camps, and we never heard anything about Ordruff, and then it must have been, I don't know how long ago, 10, 15, maybe more than that, I was reading in Reader's Digest, I believe it was the book Ike, and right at the end, there was just one line that said that he had entered Ordruff, and I looked at it, and I thought, God, I wasn't dreaming after all. I mean, here it says it in writing, Ordruff. So I wasn't imagining that I saw this, but imagining that was the wrong name for it or something. Well, then a couple of years later, I was watching television and watching the movie Ike. And then when I got to that point, it was about 3 or 4 minutes. It was quite extensive, where in the book it was just one line. In the movie, it showed a lot, and they mixed actual footage taken that day with Hollywood footage and then colorized the black and white, the old stuff. And I remember I was in the back room watching the television, and the kids were in their rooms, and I don't know where Therese was, and I just let a whoop out of me. I just went crazy. And they came out. I said, there it is, you know. And then finally I did eventually get the tape and copied it, so I have a copy of it. But up to that time, that was the first that I've heard Ordruff mentioned, other than what I remembered. And it was kind of a relief, you know, that I wasn't, that I had the right name, that what I saw, I had placed in the right place.
So you went through a rather long period of time then after the war that it wasn't a mm-hmm. a big issue.
Yeah,
in
and
your
then
life.
Just a couple of years ago, I was outdoors with the kids. We have a daycare, and I'm always outdoors in the afternoon during the summer with the kids. And I came in to go to the bathroom, and Therese went out to take my place. We switched places. I came in, the television was on. Now, it's at that time of the day, there was no kids in the house. It was on Donahue. We never watched that program. Never. I hate them. The people on there are stupid. And this day, they had a guy on it that was yelling and screaming that the Holocaust was all a fake. It was all a big propaganda thing, and there was nothing to it. And I just stood there in shock, and I was so mad. I started screaming at the television, "You stupid, you know, bad words!" And Oh, I would just go in hysterical almost, screaming at it. How can you say such stupid things? I saw it too, and people were pulling up their sleeves and said, there's my number. How can you say this didn't happen? And, you know, then finally Therese came in and she said, what's the matter? I said, look at this SOB, what he's saying. And she says, you know, calm down. You're going to have another heart attack. And I said, I'm going to write the public sees it. I said, this is ridiculous how people can say such thing. Well, just by coincidence, we used to take care of this editor's secretary's little girl.
Editor of?
The Chronicle in Muskegon, the local paper. And so I was going to write the paper and the public sees it, you know. And so Teresa called Penny and she says, Jim's on a warpath. He's sending a letter into the to the public sees it editor. And Penny says, well, just tell him to calm down. And a while back, you know, a couple hours later, she called back and said, I've talked to the editor and the powers to be down here, and they're sending someone out to talk to him. So they sent a girl out and a photographer, and we sat here, like you and I are talking here, and I think over 3 hours, and both of us were in tears, frankly, the whole time, because she had, I think her dad had some experience in it too. And then a couple weeks later on Sunday morning, whole front page, I got a copy of it here, I was going to show you, but came out, and then the telephone just went crazy. Everybody was called. Nothing bad, you know, nothing, but everybody, you know, saying, you got something to say now, get out and say it. And I finally just said, no, I can't take any more calls, I can't talk to anybody. And people were calling, they wanted me to come and talk, and
wanted you to talk to
whom? Different groups, school kids, what do you call it, service organizations. I says, I can't. I get all broke up talking about it. And because I got so shook just watching it on television there, you know. And finally a couple of real close friends says, you got something to say, say it. So I finally did agree. Before I talked my first school, I talked to the rabbi, and you know, told him what had happened, and he says, Jim, I could go say exactly what you're going to say, and they'll say, you're a Jew, you're a rabbi, you got a axe to grind, you got a chip on your shoulder, you got something to gain from this. He says, you're Catholic, you have nothing to gain, all you're doing is saying what you saw. He says, they'll believe you. So he said, please go for it. So I did. It was awful hard, terrible hard. The first time I talked was in Grand Haven to middle school. The kids were a little bit young. Those were the youngest ones I've ever talked to. The questions they asked afterwards, now I had pictures, and I showed some of my video footage that I had taken off of television of Ordra. I've collected quite a bit of it. Some of it's duplicate stuff, but their questions weren't quite thoughtful. But then one of my friends that I sing with is an English teacher at Reese Puffer. He asked me to come, and I said, okay. And I said, well, when? And he says, well, my first classes at 7 o'clock, then at 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, 1 o'clock, and 2 o'clock. I said, oh, gosh. I says, I got to make arrangements for that. I just can't leave Teresa all by herself with all the kids. So when I did do it, I spent the whole day over there. And afterwards, he had all the kids write me a letter and telling what they thought. And the one that I prized the most, it was from a boy, and he says, the usual chit-chat, but he said, this is the first time I didn't fall asleep in class. After the first class, kids were coming to the door that weren't in the class. They wanted to come in. Of course, then I was very strict time on the hour, And teachers during the day, the teachers were coming in that didn't have a class. The principals came in and sat in on the class. It was quite a moving thing. I don't know how many times I did it that first day, but I didn't get through any of them without starting to go to pieces. But then I've spoken to a lot of service groups. Usually they say, well, you're allotted half an hour, 40 minutes at the most. One time, it was almost 2 hours, and they didn't want me to stop, but I had to stop, and but then we just stood around and talked afterwards, the older people, the older kids and the older people are real appreciative, and they ask some real good questions, what was going on and stuff like that. They really appreciate it. Even though there's been for the 50 year, since the war ended, there's been a lot about that stuff on television. It's not a type of program that you would just sit down and watch because you want to. Now, if anything is on about anything about World War II, I watch it. But people are learning, and especially when you got the actual photographs and stuff like that. I think it's very important.
In light of your experiences, do you have a message for future generations who might see the
tape? Well, what I told not you can't say this to older people because it's not. But to the kids in school, I tell them, I says, okay, now 50 years from now, when some jerk like that was on Donahue comes into your room, comes into your house on this 3D television, looks like you're right there, and he starts telling you that this was all a hoax, and it was nothing to it. It's all fake. And you can say, well, this old man, when we were in school, this old man came and told us and showed us pictures because he was there. So you can say, I know this happened. In a more philosophical view, I would say learn to live with each other, for God's sakes. People, it's going on today almost as bad as it did then. The Germans did it. The Russians did it. Now they're doing it down these other countries, killing each other. For what? Why can't people live together? I don't know. That's what I'd say. Learn to live together. Peace. Shalom.
Do you have any other thoughts that you'd like to share with us?
I don't know. I think I've said enough. It's been hard. You think after 50 years, you get over it, but you don't. Maybe because I've been learning so much about it since in the last 10, 15 years. Because over there, like I said, you don't know what's going on around you. So a lot of the stuff, the details, the history and stuff like that, you learn afterwards and then have to fit what you saw in with what you saw, but you didn't know what you saw. And now we know what we saw and can put it into history. So you don't realize what significance it meant at the time, but now we do. And sometimes it makes it a little bit harder even. If we could have retained our so-called innocence and just forgot about it. But I haven't been able to do that. Other guys haven't too. I've talked to some of the guys that called up right after it came out in the paper. One guy says, I got some pictures, but I keep them hidden in my drawer and I'm afraid to take them out. I says, why? He says, well, I'm afraid someone's going to come and get me. I says, for God's sakes, take them out and show them to your kids. His kids were all growing up, married. So he did. He called back later and he says, I showed them to my kids. They couldn't believe the pictures that I had, that he had taken in, you know, different camps. And but everybody that in the GIs, some of them, we had one of my buddies' wife said, what's told Therese, what's he so hepped up about? There were other people that saw stuff like that. But Teresa says, yeah, but they won't go out and tell people what they saw. So I think that's the important thing. Not that I any sort of a hero or anything like that, but it's one of the hardest things I've ever done, like right today. But if people will listen to me, I'll tell them what I saw. And I think that's the least I can do.
Thank you.
Because so many million people did more than what I did, but they gave their lives, but at least I can tell. Maybe they won't die in vain. I don't know. I hope not. That's my story.
Thank you.
This is the picture I took the first day when we went into Ordruff. As you see, there's no GI standing around. Several days later, when Eisenhower came, he stood almost in the exactly same spot. And the picture that is so famous with Eisenhower, Patton, Bradley, all the GI standing around is almost this identical picture. And when we talk to groups, when I talk to groups, I tell them, I focus on what they saw, and the other picture focus on who was seeing it. In this shot, this is the room that I think, I'm not sure, but I think is the site that almost that made Patton sick to his stomach and he had to leave. There's some debate about it, but this is the shot. And this one looks like an old lady, but it's actually a man. If you look at the eyes, the blank look on the face gives you some idea, even though he has clothes on and that rag tied around his head, the expressions that we experience of the survivors at Ordruff. This is a portrait drawn of me right after the war ended in Bad Schwalbach, Austria, by a German PW. You see, I was very young, just 19 years old.
And what year was this?
1945.